we follow the name to the Father in heaven.
Amen.
Thank God for our fathers.
Amen.
Thank God for the earthly father he gave me.
Amen.
No longer with us.
Amen.
But I've learned so much. I learned the true meaning of love and what it means to have a father in your life. A lot of people don't get that.
Amen.
They don't have that. But so this morning I'm encouraged.
Amen.
Are you encouraged?
Yes.
I'm encouraged because I know that the Spirit of God lives in me. I'm encouraged by the encourager himself.
Amen.
He is the encourager. He's brought us life. He's given us life. And he's given us his word. And I'm encouraged because he's given us this book of life. And it encourages me. It encourages me when I can even walk through those doors and see one of you, and we can smile with one another. We can pray with one another. We can hug one another. I'm encouraged. I'm encouraged because God lives in us. His Spirit is alive. His Spirit is able. I'm encouraged. And I think we should be encouraged. No matter what we're going through, God encourages us. He is the encourager. And we must continue to put our trust in him no matter what's going on. I'm encouraged. I am encouraged this morning. I'm encouraged because he's allowed me to even get up here to speak his word. And he trusts me enough to spread his word. And I'm encouraged. I'm encouraged. He's blessed me with a family and a beautiful wife and a daughter and a son. I'm encouraged that he's blessed us with a pastor who teaches the word day in and day out. I'm encouraged that he's blessed me with members, family, and friends who love me just as much as I love them. I'm encouraged. I'm encouraged because I realize I am not alone in this journey, in this life that we have. I'm encouraged. And I pray that you're encouraged too. Because God has put it in us that we should be encouraged. Which leads me this morning to the title of this beautiful message I believe God has truly blessed me with and blessed us with. But we have to be encouraged that God is with us. And he truly cares about each one of us. So I'm going to pray first. Dear gracious Father, Lord, we thank you this morning. We thank you this morning, God, just
thank
for
you,
your Spirit, which is present.
Thank you.
We thank you for this morning because, God, we know that each morning we wake up, you want to encourage us.
Yes, Lord.
Each morning, God, you want to set the atmosphere, God.
Yes.
Each morning, God, when we wake up, you want us to hear that still, small, quiet voice that's within, God. Lord, we are encouraged this morning because we know that you're with us. So, Lord, as we go forward this morning, as you use me as a vessel, God, allow me to bring forth your word, God. Allow your love just to fill us, God, and let us realize how free and how powerful, how mighty, how blessed, how anointed we truly are, God. So, Lord, we give you thanks this morning, God. In Jesus' name, Jesus, we thank you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. This morning I want to use as a title, Trust the Process.
Amen.
Trust the Process. And it's coming from Joshua chapter 6. And so we're going to go through verses 1 through 5. Joshua chapter 6, verses 1 through 5. And I'm talking about trust the process. You may stand for a moment. Because I don't want to keep you standing. We're going to get the scripture out of the word. Trust the process. I just want you to continue to hear that. Trust the process. Okay, I'm coming from, again, Joshua chapter 6, verses 1 through 5. And it reads, "Now Jericho was securely shut up because of the children of Israel. And the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have given Jericho into your hand, its king, and the mighty men of valor. You shall march around the city, all you men of war. You shall go around the city once. This you shall do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. But the 7th day you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. It shall come to pass, when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that all the people shall shout with a great shout, then the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people shall go up, every man straight before him." May you be blessed by this word.
Amen.
May you see it. 7 stands for perfection, completion. So it's amazing when we see that number 7 a number of times in this passage. But processes, that word processes, I want to talk about that. Processes are a series of actions or steps taken in order to achieve a particular end. It's a natural phenomenon marked by gradual changes that lead toward a particular result. The process of growth, the way to achieve success. It's a procedure, an operation, activity, action, exercise, task, job, and undertaking. It's a series of actions or operations conducive to the end that's good. If we look at it from a spiritual view, or our spiritual eye, I may say, it's God's word, God's presence, God's Son, God's Spirit. It is conducive to our spirit, meaning it's favorable, beneficial, helpful, productive, profitable, effectuous, accommodating, advantageous, and encouraging for us. I'm talking about processes. That's why I'm encouraged. I'm encouraged because I'm talking about God's word, his presence, his Son, his Spirit that dwells in us. In other words, God is our source. He's our provider. He's our visionary. He's our doctor. He's our lifeline. He's our commander who gives us processes to overcome the impossible and puts it in our spirit of what's possible. You see, do you believe in your spirit? Not your carnal mind, that God can do all things. Do you believe that? Do you believe that God will do the impossible? Are you expecting God to do something great? Are you expecting that? Do you wake up in the morning expecting, "God, I'm expecting you to do something great for me because you know what it is I need. I'm expecting, God, that you're going to lift me up today because, Lord, I'm struggling right now and I need you to give me something." So what the processes are not is ineffective, disadvantageous, inconvenient, profitless, unfavorable, unhelpful, damaging, bad, and useless. You see, we follow processes in life. Did y'all know that? Every day we're following some type of process. We have processes at work we have to follow. We have processes at church, processes of parenting, but there are also processes God has put in place for us to follow. You see, we pray for results. We pray for breakthroughs. We pray for healing. We pray for deliverance. Well, I mean, we pray and we pray without stopping. We pray. But are we allowing God to do the work? You see, Joshua allowed God to do the impossible.
Right.
He followed God's lead. And it reminds me of the story of this church, this city. It hadn't rained for months. And they were in the midst of a drought, and everything was dying out. And so all the pastors and the churches, they decided to get together and pray. We're going to pray for rain. We're going to pray that it's going to rain. I mean, the Catholics brought their rosaries, and Christians had their crosses and everything. And we're going to pray that tomorrow God is going to give us the rain that we need for our crops. So they prayed. I mean, they prayed hard. I mean, they were praying up the storm, as they would say. But the next day, nothing happened. But then, that very next day, this little boy came to the church. And he said, God, he started to pray. He said, God, we need rain. We need to save our crops. And we need food. But there's one thing that the boy did that everyone else didn't do. He brought one thing that they forgot to bring, and that was his umbrella. Yeah. So the next day, what did they happen?
It rained.
You see, that boy, he was expecting. He didn't doubt.
He was
expecting for something to happen. And God did what? He delivered. And so it's important to understand, he trusted the process. He trusted God. But he prayed in his expectation, okay, if it's going to rain, I need to be dry. I don't want to get wet. And you know, this also reminds me of, I think many of you heard me mention the story time and again, because I love it. It is a good analogy. And that's even the Karate Kid. I mean, Daniel said he wanted to learn what? Karate. He wanted to learn karate because he wanted to learn how to protect himself. So what was amazing about this, his mentor, his teacher, I mean, he had him doing all these chores around the house and cleaning the floors and waxing his car and mopping and everything else, whatever he had to do, sanding the floor. And Daniel said he was getting mad. He said, I thought you were going to teach me some karate. I came here because you said you're going to teach me. So he got upset, and so Miyagi was like, Daniel, show me sand and paper, wax the wall. But he was like, wax on, wax off. And next thing you know, he's doing this and doing all kind of different moves on every time he said, do something. And he learned that. He's been learning how to do karate. But he didn't realize he was trusting the process. And I think about it, it was also a time in my life when Kelly and I were in financial need and we needed some money. And often when I was young, I would just go away and she would dial all the kids to disturb me, and I would pray. And I would pray, and one time God spoke to me, and it did not make sense at all, but I trusted him. And God said, I want you to go downstairs. I want you to put a dime on top of the door, the front door, and I want you to go out to the mailbox and put a fork in the mailbox. And I'm saying to myself, it don't make sense, I don't understand, but I believe in God. And so I did that. And then later that evening, we received this call and it was a family run, but we received the money that really we needed during that time. So I praise God for that, because I realized I had to trust the process. So here we are, even Dr. Martin Luther King, he says, take the first step in faith. You don't have to see the whole staircase, but just take the first step. But isn't that just like God to give us instructions, to direct our path, to order our steps, to prepare us, to do things we can't possibly see or even know? For he says, for I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans to give you hope in the future. It is amazing that God keeps us in suspense. I'm in suspense. I don't know about you. I'm in suspense of what God is going to do next for me in my life. Amen. The doors he's going to open up. How he's going to answer those prayers that I've been praying about. So I'm in suspense. But at the same time, I need to trust him and not doubt him. So here we are, Joshua. I'm thinking about Joshua and Caleb. They trusted God. They were the last two adults who were able to enter the promised land. You see, Moses had sent 12 spies. We know about this. He sent 12 spies to go look at the land of Canaan and come back with a report. And the only two to come back really with a favorable report was Joshua and Caleb. But at the same time, they understood, they knew God and what God had already done in moving them out of Egypt. So they were trusting everything that God was doing. They didn't doubt, but even Caleb, he came back and the people were complaining and they were murmuring, talking about these are giants, we can't take this land. And don't you know we are facing giants in life? There are things we face in life that seem impossible. Those mountains that seem impossible to move. But God is able to move them.
Yes, he is.
He's able to move those mountains that we face. You know, Caleb had to come back and he told the people to be quiet. He wanted to shut up. Listen to Moses. Caleb said, he said, let's go now and take possession of the land. We should be more than able to conquer. Because he knew God was with him. And we have to always keep that in mind, no matter what obstacles we face. I have to remind myself daily that God is with me. You see, so at the same time, two of those who had explored the land, Joshua and Caleb, they tore their clothes in despair. They said to the whole community of Israel, the land we explored is very good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will bring us into this land and give it to us. This is a land flowing with milk and honey. Don't rebel against the Lord, and don't be afraid of the people of the land. We will devour them like bread. They have no protection, and the Lord is with us. So don't be afraid of them. And so we have to remember that. We cannot be afraid of obstacles that are before. But it was also in that same, this is coming out of Numbers chapter 14, but when the whole community of Israel talked about stoning Moses and Aaron to death, they all saw the glory of God shining at the tent of meeting. They saw the glory of God. The Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to trust me in spite of the miraculous signs I have done among them? You see, God, he's giving us miracles every day. He's showing us things every day right before us. Amen. He's showing us things in his word. And he's showing us things when we pray. And, And he's showing us things in the spirit that we can't even understand, but he's letting us know I'm here.
Yeah.
He is showing us. In Joshua chapter 5, prior to chapter 6, Joshua, he was near the city of Jericho. And he saw a man standing, and he had with the sword drawn. And I love this. And then he asked him, "Are you for us or for our adversaries?" And he said, "No. But as commander of the army of the Lord, I have come now." Imagine what he saw right before him. Imagine he realized I had to continue to trust the process. I saw God bring us out. I saw God. I'm with God. He allowed me to come into the land, the promised land. Now he's showing up with the sword. He's telling me that he's the commander, and that I'm going to trust him. I'm going to do whatever it is he asks of me. And so he's going to move forward now. You know, see, that's all he had to say to Joshua. And Joshua knew God was with him. So, which takes us back again to chapter 6. Imagine that wall. That impossible wall that we could not see how we're going to get in there. The problem is they could have stormed the wall. They could have climbed the wall. They could have did whatever they needed to do to get the wall. But think about all the people they probably would have lost. Think about the bloodshed and everything that would have happened. But also think about they did not wait for God. And sometimes we get ahead of ourselves. And God wants to do mighty things in our life, and we get ahead. And he said, "No, I'm fighting this. I'm doing this." Because why? He wants us to remember that it was him.
Amen.
It wasn't our might. It was by his might. So can you trust God when you are stuck in a rut? Can you trust God when you are stuck in a situation and you don't know how you're going to get out of it? Can you trust God when all chaos and hell is breaking loose around you? You see, I have to remember, I have to trust God in all that he does. And when I remember that, and when I think about him, and when I worship him, and when I praise him, and when I cry out to him,
amen,
he renews me, he strengthens me to realize that, you know what, I'm going to make this happen. And you know what, it encourages us when we're in that bind. And when I was putting this together, I thought about my son Joshua. And one day, Kelly was there, and somehow he got his head stuck in the chair. He's a little kid, got his head stuck in the chair, and he could not get his head out of the chair. And Kelly could not figure out, how did you get your head stuck in the chair? And what was amazing, but it was her voice. Now normally think about it, a situation like that, I mean, you get out, you're going to do what? You're going to start panicking, right? You're going to start, "I can't get out," screaming, "You, I want to get out." But it was that motherly voice, that trust he had in his mother. It was amazing. She kept him calm, and then she said, "Hold up." She went to go get a camera. She went to go get a camera. This boy's big head stuck in the chair. And they try to figure out how did he get stuck. But she kept him calm. And she said, "Josh, smile, boy." And he stopped, smiled, head stuck in the chair. But what's amazing, but then they proceeded to figure figure out, okay, we gotta get them out. So he was able to screw the bottle and get them out. Still, I don't understand how he got his hand in that chair. And I wanted to look for the picture. I could put the picture up there. So I wish I had looked in the baby book, but that would have been amazing. But you know, what's amazing is during these difficult times we face in life, and we can smile and be encouraged to know that God has a plan to get us out. When we're able to even come together, encourage one another, sharpen one another, and be able to smile, knowing the challenges that you're facing, knowing what is before you, knowing that I wouldn't want this on anyone. We all have challenges that you wouldn't want on anyone. I don't want their challenges. I don't want them on me. And I hope you don't want any of my challenges. But to be able to be encouraged by God, to be able to smile and cry and just release that and know it's going to be okay, that means so much more than anything. So I'm learning that my setbacks are nothing but a setup. I'm learning that if I trust God with the process, it's going to work out. You know, what are the Jerichos in your life? What are the walls that you need God to bring down? Notice I didn't say that you need to bring down. I said that you need God to bring down. What are the Jerichos in your life? And it just so much just reminds me of my father. It amazes me when he spoke. Because we talk about Father's Day and talking about God, our Father. But when he spoke as a child, as a son, I was attentive to hear and listen. When he was teaching me things, I wanted to hear. When he was telling me his right and what's wrong, I wanted to hear. And it always echoes in my ear, hear him saying, Jimmy, right is right, wrong is wrong. But my spirit is quickened to hear that. That I know right from wrong. Because he taught me right from wrong. And so I had this expectation to take it all in when my daddy spoke. You know, he was my father and I trusted him. So I say, even this morning, probably saying, okay, how do I trust the process? First of all, we need to trust God with all our heart. We need to pray without ceasing. Yes. We need to allow the word of God to do the work. Yes. Amen. As we say in this year again, we're going to continue to pray and let God do the work. Yes. We got to let him, let that word do the work. There are so many, I'm calling them processes today, promises that God has given us, and it will be fulfilled. I'm still waiting for those days that God is going to manifest things that he's promised in my life. Amen. So I'm believing. We have to be obedient. Yes. We do. We have to be obedient and repent of those things that we know that are wrong. Again, I can't tell you what's right or wrong in your life. All I do know is if you're being led by God's Spirit, and if you're trusting God, you know right from wrong. Amen. And that's all I got to say about that. Amen. That's all. That's broad stuff to say. That's all I got to say about that. But we need to seek God first in all that we do. We need to always seek Him first. No matter how your day is starting off, no matter how your day is ending, no matter what's going on, whatever situation is before us, we got to seek Him. The next, we need to wait upon the Lord by spending time with God. Yes. I'm telling you things, these are processes that God has already given us. These are things we know. We need to spend our time with Him. We need to spend time with Him daily. Then we need to do what works best for you. I can't tell you how it works for you. What works best for me may not work best for you. But you got to know, how am I in tune with God? Some people have journals. My wife, she journals all the time, and I'm amazed. And I don't journal. But I keep saying to myself, maybe I need to. You know what's amazing? I love to write. I do those devotions 3 times a week, whatever, but I love to write. Why I don't journal, I don't know. Maybe I need to journal. This is thought for me. But some people set aside committed time to God, with God. They set aside that time, they're committed to it. This is my time. But God did not disturb me. But what works best for you? That's what I'm saying. What works best for you? How are you being in tune with God? Some people just love praising, and the next thing they know, the Spirit of God is moving. It is just moving. And but God has, He works different in all of us. But main thing is always expect results. Always expect results. Always believe. Always renew your spirit. Always renew your mind. Always renew your faith. Always allow God to move. You see, God's processes require us to listen, to trust, to believe, to have faith. Gives us endurance, and He needs us to be obedient and pray. God processes. And it's amazing when you start reading about different people in the Bible, you see those processes being worked out. Abraham trusted in the process, in obedience. He was willing to sacrifice his son Isaac on that altar. He trusted God with that.
Yes.
And when he was about to sacrifice his son, God said, "Hold up! I know you believe. I know you have faith in me." But he saw that, and he blessed him. Noah trusted the process. God favored him and gave him the blueprint on how to build the ark. And because God told him to prepare for a great flood that would destroy every living thing on earth because of the evilness of men. Nehemiah trusted the process. He cried, he prayed, he fasted, and God instructed him to rebuild the wall. With many obstacles before him, God favored him to rebuild the wall and allowed him to continue to lead the people. Naaman trusted the process. He went down to the river of Jordan and dipped himself 7 times, and he was healed. The widow of Zarephath trusted the process. She told Elijah, "I do not have enough bread, only a handful of flour and a little oil in a jar. I'm going to prepare for myself and my son that we may eat and die." But she believed Elijah when he said, "Make me a small cake first. For God said, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth," and it happened. The lady with the issue of blood trusted the process. She heard about Jesus. She heard about this man and called Jesus, so she touched the hem of his garment. She worked her way up, and she was healed. Joseph trusted the process. He was put into a pit. He was sold into slavery. He was framed. He lost his job. He was thrown into prison. He found favor because he trusted the process. And the cupbearer remembered him and told Pharaoh about him. And he found favor with Pharaoh, and he was eventually made second in command. So can you trust the process? Can you trust the process when things continue to seem to keep you down? Can you trust the process when people call your name and talk about you behind your back? Can you trust the process when it seems like financial needs just don't meet? Can you trust the process when you're struggling physically and you're aching? You just don't know what needs to be done, but you know God is there. Can you trust the process when you're at work and your boss is coming down on you and giving you all kinds of problems, but you know this is not the way it's supposed to be? Can you trust the process when you see our government seems to be folding before our arms and failing, but you know this is not the way it's supposed to be?
Take root in the rich soil of the master's garden.
with the expectation God, the master gardener, takes the seed we sow and prepares it for its season. God cultivates the seed with promise, waters it with love, and fertilizes it with the word. From the north, east, west, and south, God breathes life into the seed, creating a process for it to grow by allowing the sun to shine his glory and grace upon it. He eliminates the weeds of doubt and fear by the nourishment of the Holy Spirit and produces a harvest full of love, joy, faith, and promises. And as I always say, God is love, the joy of life. For me, it's a process of trusting God that he's not going to leave me. He promised he would never leave me nor forsake me. For you, he's the same promise. He promised he would never leave you nor forsake you. I say we serve a mighty, mighty
amen.
God.
Amen.
I say amen. So with that, I just want us to continue to understand that we have to trust the process. There's going to be days it's going to be painful. There's going to be days you just want to cry. There's going to be days you will cry. But there's going to be days you're going to rejoice and know, because he's going to let you know, I feel you. I feel you. I may need you to do this. I may need you to call this person. I may need you to go bless this person. Even though you don't understand why I want you to bless this person, just do it.
Trust me, yes.
I may need you to read this scripture 7 times. And it may not make sense, but you're being in tune with what God wants to do.
Amen.
So understand the process is there. But are you willing? Are you willing to stick to the process of what God is saying and what he's doing? Amen.
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 Amen. So I pray that we were blessed by this message.
Amen.
But more than anything, I want to pray before I even close out about this message. Dear gracious Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, just for your word. We thank you, Lord, that each person here, each person listening, each person that's not here, that's going to hear God, you know our situation better than any of us. You know the ups, you know the downs. You know the struggles, you know the victory. God, we're grateful to know that you are with us, God. Lord, even as James said, we need to count it all joy in the midst of a trial, God. So Lord, we thank you that we can smile. We can be joyful, knowing that you are going to take care of the situation. Even when others treat us bad, God, we realize your word says, you said, vengeance is yours.
Yes.
So God, we give it to you. We thank you and learn and continue to teach us the process you have for our life. And I said, at the same time, allow us to enjoy one another. Mm-hmm. Because we never know when we're going to see each other again.
Yeah.
Let us enjoy this life you've given us. We already know that life after this is going to be awesome. But Lord, we can't enjoy the time we have here. And God, it's our prayer today, God, that we will continue to serve you and strengthen one another, God. So God, we thank you. We give you glory. We give you praise. Amen.